Welcome to Man 360. I'm your host, Brian. Today, I'm in the studio of our CTN station in Pensacola, Florida, WHBR. Thank you to David Mayo and his team for helping us out today. On today's program, I have the honor and privilege of sitting down with the president of Evangel University in Springfield, Missouri, Dr. Mike Rakes. Dr. Rakes is an amazing and highly educated man, and we had a wonderful conversation about his role as the president of my alma mater. We talked about his passion and desire involving higher education, and not just the youth, but educational opportunities for everyone. In our book review segment, I asked Dr. Rakes if he would share about his new role that outlines a paradigm shift that took place after the death of his daughter, Whitney. We had a very deep and profound conversation that I know you'll enjoy. I'm glad you're here. Let's get started. Welcome to Man 360. My conversation with Dr. Mike Rakes was fun because I got to hear some behind-the-scenes thoughts from not only a university president, but my former school, Evangel University. It was fun to meet someone who was so highly intelligent, but down to earth at the same time. Dr. Rakes shared some great insights into his educational background, his goal for higher education, and I asked him about the greatest challenge and most enjoyable thing for him being the president. Then in the second half of the program, we do a review of his book, Surrendered and Unafraid, The Flourishing of Faith During Seasons of Suffering, where he shares life lessons about dealing with the loss of his daughter, Whitney. We talked about everything from his definition of faith to a word he actually created, pneumatics. Here's my conversation and book review with the president of Evangel University, Dr. Mike Rakes. So Dr. Rakes, thank you for being on Man 360.
Great to be here.
Really appreciate it.
Thanks, Brian.
So I want to talk a little bit about your kind of your formal education and what led you to be the president now of Evangel University.
Well, it's a circuitous journey for sure. I did a Master of Divinity, Reformed Theological Seminary, Doctor of Ministry at Biola University, and then had some business, a degree, a Doctor of Management degree that I did. And before that, I went to CBC for my undergrad.
You did.
I did.
The college,
I went to
it doesn't
CBC.
Exist anymore.
I know. Well, it does inside
it does
the heart
in
of Evangel. It's a part
right.
of us now.
That's
it's embedded.
Right.
I went to Southeastern there in Lakeland for a few years,
yep.
For 2 years, and then Darla and I got married and finished out here. And then ultimately, I ended up at AGTS and did a Master of Arts degree, and that was my very first master's degree back in the day. So
that's awesome.
Yeah.
So what is really your heart behind, you know, higher education for people? What do you feel like you're bringing to the table as the president of Evangel and transitioning from, you just came from a church in North Carolina and now being at Evangel, what do you feel like your heart is for higher education?
Well, the heart is both the same. I think every pastor wants to see the people in his congregation transformed. And ironically, the most dilated part of a person's life is when they're in their late teens and their early 20s, mm-hmm. When they are really open, they're looking for God, trying to find themselves. And so here at Evangel, it's about the transformation of the heart. I say it this way, education alone is not enough. Something else is missing. And what's missing is the transformation of a heart. Mm. And at Evangel, you get that. That's
yeah.
our secret sauce, that kids come here and they're transformed by God's presence.
Yeah. You know, Yolanda and I obviously are graduates, 91 and 94.
I know, we tell everybody.
So we'll be able to speak in chapel, which is awesome. We appreciate that coming up. But you know, it's interesting about how much, like you said, just that that age group too is so pliable and, you know, can be influenced by, you know, just a good, solid, well-rounded education. That's not just spiritual that
no,
way.
No, it is. Well, yeah. Well, you guys are a prime example, and we're thrilled that you're coming to speak in chapel because God uses all kinds of platforms and gifts to shine mm-hmm. his light and to get his glory. And mm-hmm. Evangel's all about that. It's not just about a Sunday morning platform, and those are critical and important, or it's not just about being a missionary
yeah.
Intent upon that or delivering compassion in that way, but through every vocation in the world, the Holy Spirit is so brilliant,
yeah.
he can use that. So
yeah.
we're thrilled to be able to claim you as alumni.
Yes, well, and also I teased a little bit about CBC. I know that was the college is absorbed into Evangel.
Right.
Also, AGTS is on campus here in Springfield
it
as
is.
Well. So, and we were talking again about a younger generation, but also for the older generation, or maybe people that are like, you know, I'm too old to go to school or go back to college. It's right. Like, we really have options for them as well.
No, you're not. We're actually creating these seminary Sherpas now that can help you navigate the higher ed world
because
it's a different language. But, you know, almost everybody, especially if they've got some years left that they've got to work, are going to have to reinvent themselves. Coming out of COVID and just the change in the culture around the world, the work culture. The truth is, the freshmen that we had coming in this year, and we had record enrollment this year surpassing what
That's
we had
great.
Projected. It's amazing.
Yeah.
353 above where we were last year.
Wow.
A headcount. But the reality is, those freshmen, by the time they're 35, 40% of the jobs that exist now will be automated. So
really?
Somebody that says, well, I'm going to skip college and just go right to work, yeah. or I just want to get a job, that's what it's about. It's not about that. You've got to have a skill to be able to innovate and pivot, and we know our graduates are going to get that skill here.
Yeah, that's awesome. And also, too, to recognize that it seems like with Evangel, with absorbing AGTS specifically, it's like you really kind of broaden the spectrum of what you could get for a degree and maybe specialize in other things besides just the standard things that you'd get from a university that way as well.
Well, AGTS just finished its 50th year.
Really?
It's been around 50? About 50 years
wow.
old. So what we decided to do in honor of that is we took a bunch of endowments, put them together, dropped our master's degree 50% off. It's actually 53% off.
Wow.
So you can get a master's degree for $9,000. All of our master's programs are 50% off. So that has really, I think, encouraged pastors, other leaders. And then at Evangel, we have other master's degrees too. They're not 50% off, but we have
like
other.
Like Master of Organizational Leadership?
Yeah, we have MOL, we have a lot of degrees. Even in the education department, we've got doctorates for people to look at. Mm-hmm. You're gonna have to keep learning, no matter what age you are.
That's
even
good.
If you just take a couple of classes. It inspires you, right? And
really
gives
good.
You energy to propel you forward.
Yeah, for sure. So last question, as the president,
right.
what do you feel like is something that is more difficult or harder as a president? And what do you feel like is actually enjoyable in what you do now?
Well, I think the more challenging thing is raising the money to really get people down the road in their education and getting them where they want to go.
Yeah.
But culture is helping us with that. So culture is making the case for us because
for sure.
if you send an 18-year-old high school kid, the only difference between a freshman in college and a high school senior is a 6-week summer vacation.
Right.
So
right.
if
it's
you
true.
Send them to a mainstream university where you've got a 40-year-old atheist who is anti-Jesus and is in the face, I don't care if that kid went 12 years to Christian school,
yeah.
it's gonna rattle their world.
Mm-hmm.
And especially if that person feels like they're on a mission, that faculty member.
Yeah.
So we believe that's made the case, but that's the hard job. I think I've gotta tell that story, keep telling that story. The fun part,
yeah.
honestly, is just finding hope again in this generation.
Mm.
Like they are unique, they really are. I don't know what COVID, all the factors, all the adversity they've had
yeah.
to overcome, they are optimistic, they are
yep.
hopeful, and they are determined to change the world.
Yeah, I completely agree with that, actually. Some people are saying that they are sad about the future generations.
No.
But even our niece who goes here as well,
right.
you know, we just see
Isabella.
Excellence in her. Yeah,
right.
We see excellence in her. We see,
right.
you know, what God is doing in her generation and even some of her friends around her. And I just really think they are the world-changing
they
generation.
Are. This generation is not a problem to be solved. They're God's answer for what he's going to do next in the earth.
So they're kind of like Black Beauty. You just hop on their back and grab onto their mane and let them run.
They are stallions running for the mountains. It's going to be awesome.
Like Valor, right?
They
Work
are.
That in too.
That
huh?
is. Come on.
You're welcome, Dr. Rakes.
Thank you. And, you know, Valor with Gideon, the
yep.
idea, Valor we define in three ways, which is curiosity, which is that desire to learn more,
mm-hmm.
right, your academics,
mm-hmm.
the courage to stand and be unapologetically Christian.
Yeah.
I'm standing for Jesus. I don't care what culture says.
Yeah.
And then the third thing is to have compassion. We have a strategic partnership with Convoy of Hope, and we're just trying to embed compassion into every discipline
yeah.
Of the university.
That's excellent.
And that's Valor.
That's excellent.
Yeah.
So I know also we're going to do a second segment here about your book that you wrote and kind of literally a paradigm shift.
Right.
It felt like when I read the book about what happened in your family.
Right.
So I want to talk about that, and we'll
Great.
Talk about your book. But well, let's watch a quick promotion for the college real
Super.
Quick.
Super.
All right.
We'll
Rakes, we didn't talk about probably one of the most, again, life-changing things that happened to your family.
Right.
In the loss of your daughter. Can you just share about that and share about your book a little bit?
Well, Whitney was our worship pastor at our church, and we were on vacation, and she found a lump on her neck and told her mom about it. And we said, sweetie, you've got to get to the doctor right away. Within just days, we had a diagnosis of Hodgkin's lymphoma.
Wow.
And we were just devastated by that. She did, so it was a four-year battle, a four-year hard-fought battle mm-hmm. through faith and standing on God's word and believing. Yeah. And we had thousands of people around the world and thousands in our church that were standing with us and believing for mm-hmm. a miracle. Whitney never doubted that, but at 27 years old, she went to be with the Lord. She's not dead today. She's very much alive, and I'm going to see her again, but it was devastating for us. Raised in a Pentecostal home where we believed in miracles.
Yeah.
And we heard about miracles all the time.
Mm-hmm.
I just expected, our whole family expected that God would come through, and he let us down in that sense. He didn't heal her the way we wanted. He didn't answer the prayers. So one of the lines in the book, I say, faith isn't what you have to use to get what you want. It's what you have to have when you don't get what you want.
Right.
And that's what God
taught. Which is horrible.
It's horrible.
It's a horrible
it's
statement.
Awful.
It is.
It's awful.
Because it's not what you've ever been taught in church and, know, just in main, just going to church. I mean, I've been in church my whole life, too. And it's like we don't relate with when God doesn't do what you think he is going to do.
Well, your own book covers it. It is this, it is this bizarre place because in church you're supposed to be victorious. Well, didn't Jesus die, so we're victorious?
Right.
Yes. But also, like Jesus, there are times of suffering.
Yep.
And we just don't talk about suffering very much. And so I actually was journaling. This is the book. I was journaling, trying to get through it.
Had you been done journaling? Sorry, real quick. Had you done journaling before Whitney's situation?
Yeah, I've been journaling since I was a young man. So I was probably 22, 23 years old.
That's
great. I felt God doing something big in my life. So I would journal, not journal like I was going to be a writer, but just documenting God's activity in my life or scriptures that meant something over the years. And so, that was a spiritual practice for me.
Yeah.
So after, I couldn't pray out loud. After Whitney died, it was very, very hard to pray. It was hard to kind of get out. And worship was very hard to listen to.
Yeah.
The suffering was great because she sang all these songs. And Whitney was just incredibly authentic,
So, yeah, for sure.
Anyway.
Well, show us the book real quick.
Okay.
I know that we have, this is your book.
Right.
That you...
Surrendered and Unafraid. So Whitney and I wrote the book together. She was in heaven. I was here. So I went through all of her journals. Her husband gave me all of her journals. We had all of the songs that she had written on her albums. She's on, you can find her music out there now, but she had written songs that she had not put to melodies yet. And so I use those words in the book. And so Surrendered and Unafraid, the flourishing of faith during seasons of suffering. Surrender and Unafraid is a phrase. Whitney was talking about, she had a paragraph and Jesus said, God, I don't know what you're going to do with me, but I'm surrendered and unafraid.
Yeah.
And that just jumped out at me and that's ended up being the title of the book.
Yeah, so real quick, this is really important, I think, too, I mentioned this, is explain the WIT, because you called her Wit.
Right.
Explain that piece at the end of every chapter for people as
well. Well, she was just hilarious, even as a kid. So I think her brother ended up, her older brother, Braden, who's a bass fisherman now, but he was, he just called her Wit, because it's short for Whitney. Shortly after that, I found myself, after she had passed, I found myself reading her journals where she's dealing in the dark with God and her faith and the cancer. So she never had one clean report in 4 years. She had a one moment where there was a clean report. It lasted 6 weeks. And every other piece of news was bad.
And horrible. That was the Airbnb that burned to the ground after she got
that
bad
was
report.
It. Boy, you did read the book.
I read that and I go, this is terrible. I'm reading this book about, your daughter going to heaven. Right. And I actually started laughing because I was relating to myself, because I remember Yolanda, when we went through our medical stuff, I said, she's like, what happens? And I said, this is just about pills, ills, and bills.
It's true. It's true, isn't it?
So when I read that, I was like, how metaphoric that the Airbnb would burn to the ground the same. Sorry,
It ended up being our last vacation together, the six of us, my son and his wife, and Whitney and her husband, and Darla and me. And the house that Whitney had picked out was gorgeous. So on the island of British Columbia thing, it was going to be amazing, and the thing burned down a month before we got there.
I read that, I was like, wow.
Go figure. We went anyway.
Yeah.
We had a good time.
You're like, we're going.
We had a great time.
So again, at the end of every chapter, you have the W, I, and T. What do those each stand for?
So it stands for wisdom. So you're looking for God's wisdom in this moment.
Okay.
Because our thoughts are not God thoughts. And that's what Whitney was reaching for. God, what are you saying? By not answering our prayers, by not giving me a clean scan, what are you saying? Give me your wisdom, integrity. Whitney was passionate about being honest about what God was and was not doing. And that's why I wrote the book.
Yeah.
I had to be honest as a pastor. And I taught her that God does miracles. We just pray and all that. And then the third part that I saw, that she just would talk about, this dogged determination. I'm going to follow you no matter what happens, and that's the tenacity.
Yeah.
So wit, wisdom, integrity, and tenacity.
I love tenacity as a word anyways.
It's a great word. It is a great
word. So I know you'd mentioned as well the people offering, and again, in our medical situation too, we had, you know, where people would, they're well-meaning, and they want to help, but it's kind of the assumption is, you know, you guys don't eat well, she needs to have something like this, you know, drink this, eat this. I know you mentioned the book that you talked about. You guys had been clean eating.
Oh,
your wife. It sounds like your wife is more kind of like the drill sergeant, a nice drill sergeant in the family. He's like, listen, we are all going to eat keto. You can get the keto bars at a Costco, but don't eat the whole box.
Yeah.
Those kind of things. But it kind of helped with the eating. You guys were already doing that before this happened.
Whitney turned out I had celiac disease. So I've been gluten-free 25 years. And Whitney was having lots of stomach cramps and stomach pain in kindergarten. So the teacher and my wife put it together, and turned out Whitney had that. So Whitney just took over her diet in first grade. And when other kids would have birthday cake
or pizza, they make them look like normal cookies.
Yep. So that was it. But Whitney ate clean and healthy. So here are people that are well-meaning and sincere, but they're sending you vitamins, or she wouldn't have cancer if she had taken care of herself. They don't know anything about her.
Right.
No, I think it's a way in which we can explain suffering. And when there's suffering we can't explain, we look for an easy excuse or an easy way to either let God off the hook or to blame the victim, to blame the person or shame them when they're going through something.
Yeah.
And both of those are wrong. And I talk about it in the book. And people that have gone through that or felt the judgment or the silent judgment of people in the church, the church people don't realize they're doing it, right? They're being nice.
Yep.
They think they're helping, but it's heaping shame on the person struggling through cancer or an illness.
Yeah.
You know?
So what would you say, or what would you speak to a well-meaning person that knows of someone going through pain? I mean, what's the response to someone like that? Because again, as Christians, we always want to give a verse. We always want to say we're praying for them. I know for Yolanda and I, one of the big things for us was, you know, I had this one friend that said, hey, let's go to lunch and I don't want to talk about what you're going through.
Right, right.
And I was like,
what
do you mean you don't want to talk?
That is what you need.
And I'm like, because you live with it every day. You think about it every day.
No, it's true.
And it's almost like where you don't want to. So what would you say as a piece of advice?
I think the main piece of advice I would give to the guys that are watching is don't try to solve the problem. Stop trying to solve it.
Okay, and that's the end of the episode right there.
It's difficult, right?
Because you want to solve stuff.
You do want to solve stuff. Let it go.
It's so hard.
Just sit with, be with someone. Pray. Yeah. You can pray for them under your breath. Pray for them afterwards, and pray. Fine with them, fine. But you don't have the answers.
Yeah.
And even though it worked for your Aunt Susie, and she took this gummy worm, and it all worked, you know, or whatever. Let it go, and let that person kind of journey with the Holy Spirit through the process and just be with them.
Yeah, I think that's important. And also just as a family, I think respecting the space of the family too.
Right.
You know, you want people to, especially in the church, being a pastor, everybody wants to help and you're like, we need our space too to be able to process this as well.
It is. Well, we don't suffer well. We're not taught how to suffer. And I think we would do better to think of ourselves, instead of being a Messiah that can walk on water, to think of ourselves more in the frame of the Holy Spirit, that we are the parakletos. We come alongside. We work in the comforting arena.
Yep.
And not necessarily always healing people.
Yeah, that's hard to say, especially coming from a charismatic.
I know it is.
Charismacostal background.
Right.
So I know you mentioned. And I'll just read this. All of us now must see how we can withstand our personal storms of grief, pain, anger, confusion, and theological mystery as the floods and winds batter our own houses of faith. So you use the word mystery a lot.
I do.
With God. And I think through the book.
Right.
And it's interesting because, again, being a pastor for a long time myself, you know, down now in Christian television, like that's not really a good word sometimes used because it's like we can't define that word. You know, where's the Hebrew, Latin, Greek root of what that is. So talk a little bit about mentioning mystery.
Well, to me, embracing mystery is actually worship. It's the highest form of worship. There are aspects to God, there's no way we could even fathom it. Mm-hmm. Even if he did tell us, there's no way we would even know and get our minds around that reality. I won't know the answers to a lot of my questions. The why chapter,
yeah.
Is that a great chapter? I'm
it
just asking the why. We have to be okay with mystery because we are not God. He is.
Okay.
And things are a mystery because we don't have full knowledge. But
in
the end, and I'm not only do I believe in miracles now, the resurrection of Jesus is everything.
Mm-hmm.
We really have to do a better job of leaning on the power of the resurrection because when we see him, and the Bible says we will know him, right?
Yep.
That mysteries will be revealed in those moments when we're in the presence of he who knows everything.
Yeah. Well, you mentioned too about how when you go through suffering, you can actually relate more with what Jesus went through in his process. We always talk about the glorified, healing, resurrected Jesus and not the one that was in the garden tomb. And was like, and I've preached this before. I said, you know, even Jesus said, hey, Dad, if there's any way we can do this, I'm down.
Right.
Like, we can do this and me not have to go to the cross.
Right.
I'm super cool with that.
That's right.
And crying to the point of actually blood, like bursting blood vessels in his face.
The stress was unbelievable.
Yeah.
And walking through bad scan after bad scan and waiting on the call, getting more bad news was unbelievable attack on our faith and just having to stay relentless, you know, in our worship.
Yeah.
Yeah, you know, think about this, Brian. In the book of Acts, so we jump to the book of Acts and all the miracles, but Jesus tells them, go to the upper room, wait to be endued with power, and everybody he's talking to is going to be persecuted, their houses are going to be burned down in just a few years, and they are chased out of Jerusalem.
Yeah.
But Jesus doesn't mention that to them.
Right.
Oh, go and wait for the Holy Spirit. So we often talk about the power, but the whole point of having the Holy Spirit is to be able to endure whatever sufferings come. Missionaries get this, people that deal in other cultures, but for us, we don't like mystery, we don't like suffering.
Right.
We like it our way.
Right.
And,
what was the old, hold the pickles, hold the lettuce, shut up, lady, you upset us. All we ask is if you would just do it our way.
You're dangerous.
I know, I have watched too much television when I was growing up, I guess. In television, watched too much television.
I know, right.
So I know that you briefly mentioned this, please expand on your definition of faith. And you mentioned it's not a tool to be used to get what you want, but to keep you from suffering.
Right. It's not going to keep you from suffering.
Yeah.
What you want to do is use your faith, have confidence that God hears you when you pray, that he knows where two or three agree on touching any one thing. All of those things are accurate. But it's not a transactional tool to get God to somehow give you something he doesn't want to give you.
Yeah.
I just don't believe that God wanted to break my heart. And yet it is the way in which I embraced suffering. Remember, because he says in the New Testament that that we will know him in the fellowship of his sufferings.
Yes.
And I know God better today than I did before I went through the loss of the most important thing in my life.
Last thing, explain pneumatics.
Pneumatics.
The word you made up.
Yes.
I didn't say that. You said that in your book. You made it up.
I did make it up.
I thought this was amazing because it really encapsulated, especially for men, I feel like this is really important.
I think
to share
it is.
Them.
Right. Pneumatics is the way the Spirit speaks to you through signs. So God's signs, which can be out there, can be in the sky, but it also could be in nature or whatever.
Yeah.
But then there are moments, these moments that the Holy Spirit delivers to the human heart where, you know, you could be watching a television show or even sometimes, you know, I'm a big, I love sports, I played sports. And there is a way in which those moments can inspire you, motivate you. You can have a really God moment that's transformational. And then the last is His Word,
yeah.
right? That His Word is a lamp unto our feet, yep. a light in our path. And so that's pneumatics, that the Spirit blows through your life and does what He wants, and He knows exactly how to communicate. So He said it this way, He has a communicational intent toward you.
Wow.
And that's why He named His Son the Word.
Which is interesting too, probably some of those principles are things you're trying to bring to Evangel.
They are.
With the students, because it's not just teaching them and saying this is a 601 or 501 or 301 class.
Once they've experienced
exactly.
His presence, no atheist is going to talk them out of that.
Exactly, because they'll remember those experiences and they'll remember when the Holy Spirit spoke to them,
period.
Given that
it
platform.
Is. It is.
So, Dr. Rakes, will you just pray for our men, please?
I will.
Yes.
I will. Father, in the name of Jesus, I just pray for the men that are watching or that are listening as they drive. I pray in Jesus' name that they would embrace whatever mystery that they can't solve, and they would lean upon You and ask You to strengthen their heart.
Yes.
Give them the courage they need to face it, the wisdom, the integrity to tell You the truth, and the tenacity to not let go of their faith in You. In Jesus' name, amen.
Dr. Rakes,
great.
Thank you
great
so much for being
Brian.
A part of the program.
Looking forward to having you at Evangel.
I appreciate that. Thank
great.
You. Let's do our 360-degree review of today's program. Dr. Mike Rakes is a man after God's own heart. I hope our conversation challenged you to think about your education and considering Evangel and their graduate programs that can also be done online. Or maybe you have a young person in your life that would benefit from looking into Evangel and their undergraduate degrees. As you can see, Dr. Rakes is a man of vision and has some big plans for Evangel's future. You can go to man360.tv/additional content right now for more information. I hope what Dr. Rakes shared about the death of his daughter, Whitney, challenged you to think through the process of painful moments in life. I love what he shared about faith not being a tool to get you what you want or to keep you from suffering, but the process of falling back on Christ when hard times hit. Maybe what he shared about suffering challenged you because you're in one of those places right now. Dr. Rakes shared in his book that all the theological knowledge didn't prepare him for this life event, and he had to relearn what it meant to go through pain. If you're in that kind of place right now, please contact us at our website, man360.tv, click on the contact link, and send us an email so we can pray for you. Thanks to Dr. Rakes for making time for us and investing in the program. Man 360 exists for men to be complete in every way through Christ, mentally, physically, and spiritually. You can always connect with us on Facebook and Instagram, and we'll see you next week, right here on Man 360. He had to rely on what Welcome to Man 360. Oh shoot, sorry.
Program intro. Take 2, 5, 4.